wish to join me in welcome to the gallery His Excellency Hamza Tibeb, the Ambassador of the Republic of Indonesia. Thank you. We now move to First Minister's questions. Question number one, Kezia Dugdale.
To ask the First Minister what engagement she has planned for the rest of the day.
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, I'm sure I speak on behalf of the whole chamber when I say that we stand with the international community in our support for the people of Nepal following the devastating earthquake on Saturday. As I announced earlier this week, the Scottish Government will donate £250,000 to the Disasters Emergency Committee Nepal Earthquake Appeal. And I would take the opportunity to urge people across Scotland to donate to the appeal if they are able to do so, so that we can all help people in Nepal rebuild their homes and their lives. Later today, I'll have engagements to take forward the Government's programme for Scotland.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And obviously, these benches offer the First Minister the full support for those remarks and that action. President Officer, what normally happens at FMQs is that I ask a question, the First Minister avoids it, and then we go back and forth for 10 minutes. I'd like to do things a little differently this week. I had planned to ask the First Minister if she will rule out another referendum, but she'll say it's for the people to decide. And then I had planned to ask her the same question again, but she would just say there will only be another referendum if there's a material change of circumstances. So can we just cut to the chase and save a lot of time during this busy election period? Can the First Minister simply repeat the exact words she used on the 25th of August last year when she said the referendum was a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity?
First Minister.
If the people of Scotland want a referendum
order.
To be once-in-a-lifetime opportunity, that is exactly what it will be. Let me say to Kezia Dugdale.
Order.
Let me say to Kezia Dugdale. This is
order.
Desperate, yes. Last throw of the dice stuff from Scottish Labour. Talk about a party in its death throes. The desperate scaremongering over full fiscal autonomy clearly hasn't made any impact on the polls. Well, actually, that's not true. It has made an impact on the polls. The SNP poll rating has gone up. But given that it hasn't helped Scottish Labour, they're now resorting to desperate scaremongering about a referendum that nobody is proposing. Let me make it very, very clear. And for Kezia Dugdale and Scottish Labour's benefit, let me put it in very simple terms. This election, one week today, is not about independence. It's not about a referendum, no matter how many seats the SNP win, and we are working hard to win as many as possible. That is not a mandate for a referendum. What this election is about is making sure that Scotland's voice is heard much more loudly at Westminster than ever before. And having experienced Scottish Labour MPs that go to Westminster and are never heard of again, it is time for Scotland's voice to be heard.
Ms. Dugdale.
I don't know about you, Presiding Officer, but that wasn't quite repeating the promise made to the SNP to the people of Scotland. The promise was that the referendum was a once-in-a-lifetime event, that no matter how we voted as a nation, we would get back to dealing with the really important issues, like the fact that the reading levels of kids of all ages in Scotland have declined in the last 2 years, like the fact that next to no progress has been made to close the gap between those from the poorest and wealthiest backgrounds in our schools. The First Minister has all this power at her disposal, but what is it for if it's not to transform the lives of working class kids? Now, again, I know if I ask the First Minister about her 2016 manifesto, she will say she hasn't started writing it yet. But we know that isn't true, because Nicola Sturgeon's conference speech contained 2016 manifesto promises.
Order.
On the small business bonus scheme, on childcare, on the National Health Service. So can the First Minister today...
Order.
Can the First Minister today rule out a referendum in her 2016 manifesto?
First Minister... First Minister, order.
For just a fleeting second there, I thought Kezia Dugdale was going to ask a serious question.
Absolutely.
When she started talking
order.
About Scottish education. Because let me say this, there's much to celebrate in Scottish education, but the results that were published yesterday are not good enough, and I'm determined to improve them. This government is determined to improve them. But, you know, on the question of a referendum, you know, can I offer, I've made the position of the SNP very, very clear. And, of course, ultimately, in the 2016 election, indeed in any election, it is for the Scottish people to decide who to vote for and who not to vote for. The Scottish people are in charge at every single step of the way. I was going to ask Kezia Dugdale what the problem is that Scottish Labour seem to have developed with democracy. But then I looked at the opinion polls and I think I know the problem Scottish Labour have got with democracy. Perhaps I can offer Kezia Dugdale a little bit of friendly advice. Over the next 6 days, perhaps Scottish Labour might want to look at the polls themselves and desist from the negativity and the scaremongering and instead try to muster, if they can possibly find one, a single positive reason for voting Labour.
Kezia Dugdale, Ms Dugdale.
President Officer, I look at the polls, I see them all the time, we talk about them all the time in the TV studios. Yeah.
Order.
Do you know what? If those polls are realised next week, there'll be pink champagne for everyone. Rupert Murdoch will be buying it. David Cameron. Alex Salmond will be pouring it.
First Minister. Sorry, Ms Dugdale.
Rupert Murdoch will be buying it. Alex Salmond will be pouring it. And David Cameron will be drinking it. That is the reality of those polls.
Order.
Presiding Officer, the First Minister just said a second ago that no one is proposing a second referendum. That's not true. In the last half an hour, Jim Sillars, the former deputy leader of her party, has said that there's no question that another referendum will be in her manifesto next year and that her party members will demand it's in the first line of that manifesto. Last night, her candidate in Glasgow East said that we should wait to see the result of next week's election before the SNP decide about another referendum. Her candidate in West Dunbartonshire, in Glasgow North, in Paisley, and in Inverness, in Caithness, and in Livingston all see the general election as another step on the march to another referendum. When the SNP candidate in Midlothian said it wasn't a no vote, it was just a not yet, was that respecting the result of the referendum?
First Minister.
This, honestly, you know, desperate doesn't quite cover it. You know, I know I'm in opposition to Labour, but even I find it quite sad watching the demise of a once proud party. You know, the great heroes of the Labour movement must be turning in their graves right now. Not a single positive reason for voting Labour, just the same old negativity, scaremongering that they indulged in arm in arm with the Tories during the last referendum campaign. Let me make it quite clear. Now, I've got the greatest of respect for Jim Sillars, but the clue is in his title. Former deputy leader of the SNP and the current leader of the SNP. So let me say it clearly once again. This election is not about independence. It's not about a referendum. It's about making Scotland's voice heard. And then it's about using that strong voice at Westminster to stand up for progressive politics, to argue for an end to austerity, to argue for protection for our public services, to argue in the kind of investment in our economy that we need to get people into jobs. That's what a vote for the SNP is about next Thursday, and I hope people across this country seize that opportunity.
Kezia Dugdale. Ms Dugdale.
President Officer, the First Minister asked for one good reason to vote Labour next year. I'll give her it. Let's reintroduce the 50p tax rate and use the money that generates to close the inequality gap in our schools. Because just yesterday, Presiding Officer, new figures were published which showed that working class kids are getting left behind by this SNP government. Even now, in 2015, a child's ability to read and write is directly linked to how much their parents earn or where they live. That's a moral outrage. It's a scandal. Yet all the SNP candidates can talk about is another referendum. For any government.
Order! Order! Mr Fitzpatrick, enough.
For any government with the right priorities, the three R's would mean reading, writing and arithmetic. Isn't it the case that under the SNP it simply means referendum, referendum, referendum?
Oh. First Minister.
This is totally and utterly farcical from Scottish Labour. The only people in Scotland right now talking about a second referendum are Scottish Labour. Scottish Labour.
Order.
Just about an hour ago, presiding officer, a party in Scotland launched a billboard poster about a second referendum. Do you know what? It wasn't the SNP, it was Scottish Labour. That's who are talking about it. You know, I know Labour's campaign.
Order.
I know Labour's campaign is in dire straits, but I want to not miss the opportunity today to thank Kezia Dugdale for her email on Tuesday. It came from her direct to the First Minister's official email inbox, asking me if I would be part of Labour's volunteer effort on election day. Can I?
Order! Come on, behave!
I don't want to pile more misery onto Scottish Labour right now. So let me break this gently to Kezia Dugdale. I think I'm busy that day.
Question number two, Ruth Davidson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, to ask the First Minister when she'll next meet the Secretary of State for Scotland.
First Minister.
No current plans.
Ruth Davidson.
Presiding Officer, we've just seen the First Minister gloating over the numbers going up in the polls, and what concerns me more is a serious question, as she identified, and that's the serious question of the numbers showing literacy standards going down in our schools. On the campaign trail, each party is rightly talking about opportunities for our young people, and the best way to increase opportunity is through a good education. And yet we find yesterday that literacy skills in our schools are getting worse, not better. At P4, at P7, at S2, standards in reading and writing have fallen over the last 2 years, and the people being failed most are the children from the poorest backgrounds. This has happened entirely on the Scottish Government's watch, and it is a scandal. Now, I know that the Scottish Government yesterday hastily put together a press release filled with action plans and improvement frameworks for this. But does the First Minister really think this is adequate to tackle what is becoming a crisis in school standards?
First Minister.
Well, can I firstly genuinely thank Ruth Davidson for asking a serious question, because I think this is a very serious matter. I said in response to Kezia Dugdale just a few moments ago that there's much to celebrate in Scottish education, and I will always make sure we take the opportunity to do that. But the results that were published yesterday, and let me make this absolutely and totally blunt, they are not good enough. And I, as First Minister, am determined that we improve them. We are determined that we improve standards in our schools overall, but also that we close the gap in attainment between young people living in our least deprived areas and those living in our most deprived areas. That is one of the, I think, most sacred responsibilities of any government, and as First Minister, it's one that I am personally passionate about. I think Ruth Davidson was slightly unfair when she described the announcement yesterday by the Education Secretary as hastily drawn up, because she will recall that several weeks ago now, in fact a couple of months ago now, I announced the establishment of the Scottish Attainment Challenge, backed by extra funding of £100 million. We are determined, and I am personally determined. I know personally, as many of us do, the value of a good education. And I am determined that my government meets the responsibility we have to ensure that every single young person in our schools gets the best education.
Ruth Davidson.
Hey, Presiding Officer, I hear what the First Minister is saying, but the problem is that I've heard it all before. Because this time last year, the Scottish Survey's numeracy figures were published, and they too showed that numeracy standards were going down. And guess what? The Scottish Government's response was, just like yesterday, to stick out a press release, to promise a new action plan, and to hope that the story goes away. They are sticking plaster solutions designed to get through a news cycle, and all the while, our classroom standards are declining. Now, yesterday, the First Minister, in her press release, pledged to study the best international practice. Well, I can tell her what that international practice shows. It shows that if parents and teachers are given more control over their schools, then standards will rise. Casting off the one-size-fits-all town hall knows best approach and allowing true diversity in the way we teach our children. I don't doubt the First Minister's intentions, but does she have the resolve to ditch the dogma and the government by press release and undertake genuine reforms that are needed?
First Minister.
Can I say a number of things to Ruth Davidson? Firstly, the government introduced these surveys so that we know what's happening in our schools and we have the information we need then to improve what is happening in our schools. And as she knows, we have established the Scottish Attainment Challenge. We've also established the Read, Write, Count campaign. We've also established the Raising Attainment for All programme, which now covers 23 local authorities and 180 schools across our country. So while I agree with the premise of Ruth Davidson's question, I think she is being unfair to say that this government has not been taking action to address this. I am, and you know, I say this with no defensiveness, because the education of our young people is the most important responsibility of a government. I am determined to make sure we have the best standards in our schools for all of our children. If there are improvements that require to be made, we will seek to make them. And as we seek to make those improvements, let me be very, very clear, Presiding Officer, no dogma, no ideology, no political considerations will get in the way of us doing what needs to be done on behalf of the children of this country.
David Torrance.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Presiding Officer will know that a number of the workforce of Tillis Russell in her constituency reside in my constituency. Could the First Minister update Parliament on what action the Scottish Government is taking to support those affected by Tillis Russell's move into administration?
First Minister.
Well, I know the Presiding Officer will be particularly interested in the answer to this question. The announcement by Tillis Russell earlier this week that the company had gone into administration is a devastating blow for Fife, particularly for the employees of that company, and our thoughts are with them and their families at this very difficult time. That same day, the Scottish Government announced the establishment of a task force which will be jointly convened by the Deputy First Minister and the leader of Fife Council. The Deputy First Minister visited the site on Tuesday to meet with managers and staff and to underline the commitment of the Scottish Government to assisting all those affected. That task force will look at all options and all possibilities for finding a buyer, but we don't underestimate the challenges that lie ahead. But every effort will be made by the Government to provide all assistance to those affected, and that's a cast-iron commitment that I give to this chamber.
Question 3, Willie Rennie.
To ask the First Minister what issues will be discussed at the next meeting of the Cabinet.
First Minister.
Matters of importance to people of Scotland.
Willie Rennie.
Can I first thank her for the efforts that John Swinney and herself are making on Tillis Russell. My wife was made redundant on Monday from Tillis Russell, and I know the workers at the plant are appreciative of the efforts by the Government. But can I turn to the issue of the second referendum? She may think that she has answered the question, but it's quite clear she could make a statement right here, right now, that in the next term of this Parliament, there will not be another referendum. Why can't she just simply say that?
First Minister.
Well, you know, I think I've made this absolutely crystal clear. Unless there is some change to the circumstances that prevailed during the last referendum, when the people of Scotland debated and decided this issue, there will be no proposal for another referendum. That's the first point. But the second point is this, and it's a fundamental democratic point that I would have thought the leader of a party with the word Democrat in its name would be able to grasp. If the SNP ever does propose in a manifesto a second referendum, that in and of itself does not bring about a referendum. People in Scotland first have to vote for that manifesto and give the SNP sufficient numbers in this Parliament to get the legislation through. That's democracy. The decision ultimately lies with the people of Scotland. What is this problem with democracy that the other parties appear to have developed?
Will there any?
The problem with that answer is that the biggest democratic experience of our life, last September, heard quite clearly the First Minister say there wouldn't be another referendum for a lifetime. And this is the never-endum that we warned about. We saw the consequences of the whole machinery of government being focused on the referendum for the last 3 years. The NHS and the police bear witness to that problem. And in Quebec, we have seen the long period of political uncertainty. in Quebec and the economic consequences of that too. That's why people are concerned about this. They're concerned about it on the doorsteps. So she could make it quite clear. She could make it quite clear today. It's very simple. We're not even asking her to rule it out for a lifetime. Just rule it out for the next Parliament. That's what we're asking for. Why can't she do it?
First Minister.
Willie Rennie talks about Quebec and never-endums. What he doesn't tell people is in Quebec there have been, yes, two referendums. They were 15 years apart and the last one was 20 years ago. That's not really the picture he paints. If the people of Scotland want a referendum to be ruled out for a generation, a lifetime, 10 lifetimes. That's exactly what will happen because the people of Scotland are in charge. That's the fundamental principle. And you know what? I don't know how many doors Willie Rennie has knocked in this campaign. I'm sure it is quite a lot. But what people are saying to me on the doorsteps in the streets of Scotland is not about another referendum. The concerns they're raising are about the cuts that his party, hand in hand with the Tories, have imposed over the past 5 years. And what they want in this election is a party that will stand firmly and squarely against austerity. That party is the SNP.
Question four, Christine Grahame.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, to ask the First Minister what recent communications there have been between the Scottish Government and the Home Office regarding an independent inspection of Dungavel Detention Centre.
First Minister.
The SDUC, the Church of Scotland, the Catholic Church, the Muslim Council of Britain and the Scottish Refugee Council have all requested an urgent collective meeting with detainees at Dungavel, which the Home Office has thus far refused. Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice wrote to the Home Secretary about the situation at Dungavel on the 26th of March and urged her to grant permission for the visit requested, but as of this morning we've not yet received a response to the Cabinet Secretary's letter.
Christine Grahame.
I thank the First Minister for her answer. The denial of access by those groups and indeed the delayed publication of the report by HM Inspectorate following an inspection in February is of great concern, with disturbing reports of hunger strikes, lengthy detentions with no notice of when these will end and transfer at a moment's notice. These are surely matters of urgency. Does the First Minister consider that denial of access, delay, has something to do with awkward truths during a general election when convicted criminals in our prisons have the protection of human rights, while people whose only crime is to seek asylum in the UK have next to none?
First Minister.
Well, I very much share Christine Graham's concerns. I think we can only imagine the desperation of people detained, often far from home, with no time limit on their detention and no idea of when they might be released. I think it is important to say that to seek asylum is a right, it's not a crime. And that's why the Scottish Government supports the recommendation of the all-party groups on refugees and migration in their recent report into the use of immigration detention, that there should be a time limit of 28 days on the length of time that anybody can be held in immigration detention, and that the presumption should be in favour of community-based resolutions. It's also why the Social Justice Secretary has urged the Home Secretary to allow the STUC and the churches access to Dungavel to meet detainees and hear their concerns. You know, I think it's important to say the fact that we are in the run-up to a general election should not make any difference at all to the exercising of anybody's human rights, particularly when we're talking about the human rights of some of the most vulnerable people in the country.
Question five, Malcolm Chisholm.
To ask the First Minister what level of public expenditure the Scottish Government considers necessary in order to beat austerity.
First Minister.
Austerity will end when Westminster stops making cuts, when it stops targeting the most vulnerable in our society, and it stops holding back economic growth for the sake of political dogma. That's exactly what the SNP propose in this election. We propose an end to cuts and modest spending increases in each year of the next Parliament that will see the deficit reduce, but also free up at least an additional £140 billion to invest in skills, in infrastructure, in our National Health Service and in measures to protect the vulnerable and lift people out of poverty.
Malcolm Chisholm.
I'm sure the First Minister would like to end austerity, although I'd advise her to dump full fiscal autonomy in that case. But isn't her whole strategy based on distorting and misrepresenting Labour's fair plan to end austerity, which the Institute of Fiscal Studies has said will deliver more spending at the end of the next Parliament than her proposals? Isn't she ashamed of the nauseating rubbish we've heard from her MSPs for months about Labour and Tory spending plans being the same?
First Minister.
You see, The slight problem Malcolm Chisholm has in citing the IFS is that Ed Miliband last week, after the IFS report was published, said it was wrong. He said he disagreed with it for three different reasons. He said it underestimated the scale of the cuts Labour wanted to make. And I have to say, it's not me that has caused the problems, or not just me that has caused the problems, for Scottish Labour's attempts to pretend that they're anti-austerity. It was Ed Miliband and Ed Moles who slapped down Jim Murphy and said, regardless of what he says, he won't be writing the budget, and yes, there will be cuts under Labour. So the choice for people in Scotland is clear. If you want continued austerity, you've got a choice of three parties, Labour, the Tories, or the Liberals. If you want an end to austerity and spending increases to help the most vulnerable, protect our public services, the only choice is the SNP.
Mark MacDonald.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Is the First Minister aware of the recent study by the Centre of Macroeconomics, which found that two-thirds of economists surveyed disagreed that the coalition policies had had a positive effect on the economy? And given that, despite Malcolm Chisholm's protestations, the Labour Party are also wedded to a cuts agenda, does the First Minister agree that what we need is a strong team of SNP MPs who will end the austerity obsession at Westminster?
First Minister.
Yes, I do agree with that. But we don't need, however respected they might be, and you know, we all heard Paul Krugman, a very respected economist yesterday, criticise Labour for being so weak when it comes to austerity. But however respected the economists might be, we know from the experience of speaking to our own constituents how damaging the austerity agenda has been. It's pushed children into poverty, it's undermining our public services, and it's holding back the growth in our economy. We need an end to cuts. We need an alternative to austerity. And if people of Scotland want to make sure they've got MPs in the House of Commons arguing for that, then they need to vote SNP and send a massive team of SNP MPs to Westminster.
Gavin Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Approximately how much additional public expenditure is the Scottish Government calling for in 2015-16?
First, well, our own budget, as Gavin Brown will be aware, is going up by, I think, £600 million in this financial year. Over the lifetime of the next Parliament, we've said very clear our alternative to austerity will free up £140 billion to invest in the NHS, to lift people out of poverty and to get growth in our economy. That's the choice people have. If they want continued austerity, then they can choose between Labour, their pals in the Tories, and their pals in the Liberal Democrats. If they want an end to austerity, they need to vote SNP.
Question 6, Alex Fergusson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister what the Scottish Government's position is on reports of issues relating to the new single application form IT system.
First Minister.
Well, this is the first year of the new payment system for the more complex common agricultural policy. Well, the core of the new system is working well, with 17,000 farm businesses having registered successfully on it. We're aware that some users have experienced issues in the application process. Indeed, other EU countries have experienced similar problems. IT staff are monitoring the system constantly and working hard to fix issues to ensure that the new system works well. The Government's processing team are also happy to support applicants who encounter difficulties, and we've extended the deadline for the submission of single application forms by 1 month to the 15th of June to allow for more time to get used to the system and rules of the new CAP programme. In addition, we recognise that online applications don't suit everyone and paper applications are still welcome.
Alex Fergusson.
Well, I appreciate the First Minister's response, but I genuinely worry about the information she's being given, because the fact is that this online system has already been cost over £130 million, more than twice its original estimate, and it just isn't working. The Cabinet Secretary has frankly admitted defeat by extending the application deadline by a month. Agents have given up on the system and are now having to photocopy paper application forms, because the government's run out of new ones. And then just last weekend, we learned that some 200 government employees working on the new system have been sacked and replaced by inexperienced agency staff, many of whom are on Tier 2 visas. This shambles, because that is what it is happening on her Cabinet Secretary's watch, but it's Scotland's farmers who are going to pay the price. So quite simply, what is she going to do to get a grip on this situation?
First Minister. I don't accept the characterisation of the issues involved there, though I do accept there are issues and we are working to address those issues. In terms of the issues around visas, the member should be aware that there has been extensive engagement with the Home Office on that issue, and its investigations have found no evidence of the allegations that have been made. In terms of the wider issues that Alec Fergusson raises, 17,000 farm businesses have registered successfully on this system, but we understand that some users are experiencing issues in the application process. That's not unique to Scotland. Other EU countries, including England and Wales, are experiencing similar problems. We are working to address these issues, and we will continue to do so. And I know that the Cabinet Secretary would be very happy to meet with Alec Fergusson if he wants to take me up on that offer, to sit down and discuss these issues and discuss the feedback he is getting from constituents of his. We're determined to resolve these issues, and Richard Lockhead is working hard to do so.
Sarah Boyack.
Can I also welcome the fact that farmers and crofters have been given both extra time to fill in these incredibly complex forms, but also that to date there's a commitment that the payments will be made on time? I think everybody in the industry welcomes that. But will the First Minister commit to personally investigate and to ask for a high-level inquiry into why repeated warnings that this was a botched process and was going to fail were not acted upon, and that this has led to huge stress and uncertainty amongst our farming and crofting communities, and that the costs have more than doubled, and that's just for the administration behind the system, never mind the extra resource that's going to have to go in to make sure that this payment money is going to come out on time?
First Minister.
Well, can I thank Sarah Boyack for her question and for the way in which she's asked the question? I think she is right to point to the sensible move that's been made to extend the timescale, and she's also absolutely right to point to the fact that the commitment is given that payments will be made on time. If there are particular issues that Sarah Boyack or any member across this chamber wants me and the Cabinet Secretary to look into in more detail, we are very happy to do that. We are determined to resolve and address the issues that are being raised, and we will continue to make sure that we take all appropriate action to do so.
Thank you. That ends First Minister's questions. Those who leave the chamber should do so quickly and quietly, because we are about to move on to members' business.